Well, it's a great pleasure to have James Drummond giving today's Zoom seminar. He needs no introduction to this audience, I would imagine, because he spent some time here in Dublin at Trinity. So I will hand you over to James. He's going to tell us about cluster algorithms, tropical geometry, and scattering amplitudes.
Great. Well, thank you very much for the invitation to give this talk. It's a great pleasure to be talking to the Dublin theoretical community again. So I would like to describe some work that we've been doing over many years on scattering amplitudes. And I just thought I would begin by just reminding you of some very basic things of what we do when we're computing scattering amplitudes. So we begin by opening our favorite textbook and writing down a bunch of Feynman diagrams. And these can be tree diagrams like the one I've drawn or loop diagrams. And we'd glue vertices and propagators together. And then we have to evaluate these diagrams and then add up the answer to get our amplitude. And there are lots of complicated steps in that. But one of the most complicated things is the just basic thing that for complicated processes, there are very, very, very many diagrams. So there's a lot of stuff to do. On the other hand, for some quantities, the simplest quantities, you can just write down the answer. So this is a famous formula due to Park and Taylor. It's more than 30 years old now, for the maximally helicity violating gluon amplitude. And it's an all multiplicity result. So it's a remarkable thing that for certain quantities, all that mass of complicated diagrams actually boils down to a single term. So this is really a clue that there's something more going on here than the traditional textbook formulation of quantum field theory in terms of computing on-shell quantities like amplitudes. Now, there are various refinements of this observation and techniques. You can use analytic techniques to construct things like recursion relations or unitarity to construct an integrand. So some quantity where you first work this out, and then there's a bunch of loop integrals that you still have to do if you're computing some loop correction in perturbation theory. And then, of course, once you have that, you have to integrate those integrals. You have to do the integrals. And what I really want to emphasize for this talk is that you should think of what I'm trying to do here, trying to explain here, as an alternative to all of this approach. The alternative really is, can we understand the geometry behind integrated amplitudes? And if we can understand that geometry, can we just write down those amplitudes without having to first construct some integrand and then integrate and perform some complicated integration? So can we just jump to the answer? Okay, so that's a taster of what I want to describe. Let me just say concretely the steps that I want to outline. So the first thing I want to do is I want to describe scattering amplitudes in planar kinematics. I want to describe the space of planar kinematics, and I will relate those to Grassmannian spaces. And that will be principally focused on the case of planar n equals 4 superangmills, which is a kind of a canonical example, which is reveals, it's simple enough to reveal a lot of this underlying structure, but yet rich enough to have all this structure that you can sort of peel back layer by layer. So it's a very useful example to work in. And we'll find that amplitudes are typically described by iterated integrals on this space. And for those, we will need sets of singularities. And there's a very nice algebraic geometric tool called cluster algebras, which provide for us candidate singularities that will allow us to construct these integrals. And when we have this, we actually get a bonus. We find that it also wants to describe for us the relations between these singularities, successive discontinuities, for example, in perturbation theory. But it will leave us with a puzzle. It will suggest to us that when we go to high enough multiplicity or beyond a low multiplicity, we will have potentially infinite sets of singularities. This doesn't square with what we know from perturbation theory. So we'll want to introduce another tool, which is tropical geometry. A tropical geometry is a kind of a limit or a, kind of linearization of some complicated geometrical space. In here, I want to talk about the Grassmannian, so I'll be talking about tropical Grassmannians. And what's interesting about it is it preserves lots of information about the original space, but it's much easier to work with. And we will be able to relate these tropical geometries to the cluster algebras, and they will provide for us a resolution of this peculiar puzzle about infinitely many singularities. And at the same time, they will provide for us a way of generating non-rational singularities. I'll be more precise about what I mean about that when I talk about these functions, but there are certain singularities that could never have come directly from cluster algebras. But when we combine the two things of the cluster algebra and the tropical geometry, we will in one go get rid of the infinity, but also generate some of these algebraic singularities, which we know are also necessary to describe loop scattering amplitudes. Okay, so let me talk about kinematics. So when we talk about kinematics, we have some set of momenta, P1 up to Pn, and I'm going to be planar here, so I'm going to give them a cyclic ordering, P1 up to Pn. And they come in and do their scattering process, and these momenta satisfy two sets of constraints. The first is momentum conservation. The sum over all incoming momenta vanishes. The second constraint is that they're on shell. This is the massless condition for gluons, say. So I have Pi squared equals zero for massless scattering. Now I can solve the first condition naturally in planar kinematics by introducing a set of dual variables. I write the ith momentum is the difference between two dual coordinates, xi plus one minus xi. And that gives me this picture in the middle at the top, this piecewise light-like contour, where the x's are the corners and the p's describe sequentially all the edges. And it goes around in a sort of polygonal light-like loop because of momentum conservation, it closes. The on-shell condition can be solved by introducing good old spinner helicity variables. So this is where I write my four momentum as a 2x2 matrix with chiral and anti-chiral spinner indices, alpha, alpha dot, I've written here. And the on-shell condition tells me that the determinant of this 2x2 matrix should vanish. So therefore it should have rank one, and I should write P is equal, I can factorize my momentum as a chiral spinner lambda and an anti-chiral spinner lambda tilde. Okay, and when I do this, I'll get a redundancy because of course I can rescale lambda, and as long as I rescale lambda tilde oppositely, it won't change the momentum P. So this introduces a redundancy. Okay, now I really want to introduce a different set of variables, which is indicated on the top right, these dots connected by lines. And I'm going to do this by introducing the incidence relation. I will define mu for each particle I as xi contracted with lambda. And then the pair lambda and mu together is going to be one of a twister variable. This zi is a twister variable. And it's a projective variable because of that rescaling ambiguity. If I rescale mu and lambda in the same way, then I see that z scales homogeneously and I should mod out by this scaling. And the good thing about these z's is that they satisfy no constraints. So apart from the fact that I've got this scaling ambiguity, all I need to describe planar massless scattering is just a set of n of these projective z's. It's completely equivalent to the massless planar kinematics. And moreover, what's nice about them is that there's a new symmetry in planar n equals 4 called dual conformal symmetry, and that just acts linearly on these z's by 4x4 matrices. So the natural invariance, therefore, will be the minors, the determinants of the minors that I get when I stick four of these z's together and then take the determinant of that 4x4 matrix. That will be invariant under SL4. Okay, so that I'm going to denote by these brackets with IJKL to denote the four particles that I put into it. Okay, so I'll call these minors or Plucker coordinates or four brackets variously, may not be consistent with my naming, but all of those things mean the same thing, these IJKLs. All right, so we know that our kinematics can be described by these N twisters. So let's just arrange them into a 4 by N matrix, ZIA. And now I want to think of the rows of this matrix as being 4N component vectors. So what do 4N component vectors give me? They give me, they span a four-dimensional plane in N dimensions. They tell me some plane. And then dual conformal symmetry is SL4. So that just rotates these four vectors in the plane, but it doesn't change the plane. It leaves them all in the same plane. So when I mod out by dual conformal symmetry, really what my matrix does for me is it characterizes the space of planes, four-dimensional planes in N dimensions. And this is what we call the Grassmannian space. It's the space of planes, space of K-planes in N dimensions, generically. And remembering that these Zs are projective, then the number of dimensions this space has is 3n, because I've got n columns, minus 15 for the generators of SL4, that's the dual conformal symmetry. So my dimension is 3n minus 50. And you'll notice that if I put in n equals 4 or 5, I don't get a positive number. I only start getting positive numbers from n equals 6 and beyond. So this is the statement that dual conformal symmetry completely fixes the scattering amplitudes at 4 points and 5 points in planar n equals 4 super young mills. And then there becomes something interesting for them to depend on, even in the presence of dual conformal symmetry, when we go to 6 points and higher. Okay, so amplitudes are functions on this space, this Grassmannian. So they're functions of the kinematic data, so they're functions on this space. And they're also functions of the coupling. And in a planar theory, we have the Toft coupling. So I will, as we normally do, perturbatively expand in the Toft coupling. So I will have a sum over powers, lambda to the L, for L loops in the Toft coupling. And the coefficient at L loops will be the L loop amplitude. And now that's literally just a function on the Grassmannian, depends on Z only, on this matrix of Zs. Now at low orders in perturbation theory and low multiplicities, then experimentally we find that these L loop amplitudes are given by a sum of iterated integrals of weight 2L. So let me just say what that means and give a couple of examples. Let me go to the first example, which was 6 points. At 6 points and one loop, I have three variables, because 3n minus 15 is 3 for n equals 6. I've called them u1, u2, u3, but it doesn't matter. The point is the right-hand side. It's given by just a very simple expression involving a bunch of die logarithms, Li2s. And if I go to two loops, you'll see analogously down here that I see a bunch of things that involve things like Li4s. And this L4 function also involves some Li4s and some logarithms and so on, such that the total degree of this whole expression is 4. I actually included the definitions, but it doesn't matter. Those definitions are just to convince you that everything at two loops is some weight 4 combination of logs and polylogs and so on. Okay, so what are these LINs? Let's just remind about these LINs. LINs are iterated integrals. So the polylog LIN is just an integral dt over t of the n minus 1, LIN minus 1. And I have to tell you how to start this recursion. So LI1, that's just a logarithm, minus the log of 1 minus x. Okay, so I have a recursive iterated integral definition for these polylog functions here. Now, more generally, we don't just need functions of one variable. Up to two loops at 6 points, we could get away with writing things in terms of functions of one variable and their products and sums of those. But in general, we need genuine functions of multiple variables, 3n minus 15 of them in general. So the way we do this is rather through a differential definition, or a way to do it is through a differential definition. I will say that an iterated integral of weight k, fk, obeys the property that if I take its total derivative, then I can write dfk, the total derivative, in terms of a certain finite set of d logs. Okay, so there'll be d log phi for some rational functions of my variables. So phi is a rational function of my variables. This will be a finite sum. So there'll be a particular list of allowed rational functions, phi. And then for each coefficient of d log phi, there will be a weight k minus one function multiplying it. Okay, so the coefficients will be weight k minus one. And again, this is a recursive definition. So I have to tell you how to start at weight one. And at weight one, these are just rational linear combinations of the logs of those rational functions phi. Okay, so that defines a class of functions. If I tell you what is this set of rational functions phi that I'm allowing that can appear in these d logs. So in the line above, when I was talking about ln of x, the rational functions would just have been x itself and 1 minus x, because you'll see the first one is the log of 1 minus x. So I need to allow 1 minus x. And then x appears, you'll see in the integral, it's dt over t. So when I take the derivative of ln of x, I'll get d log x appearing. So the letters phi in that example would just be x and 1 minus x. Okay, more generally, I can specify, given some set of variables, my own alphabet of letters phi, which will be rational functions of those variables. And later on, I'm going to talk about algebraic ones, but let's stick with rational for now. So we'll allow rational functions phi. Now, once I've got this definition, there are some useful things that we can introduce to describe these functions. So one such thing is the symbol, and I'm just going to do this following the differential definition above. So I will say that the symbol of fk is exactly that same sum, where instead of fk minus 1, I write the symbol of fk minus 1, and instead of d log phi, I just record its argument, and I tensor those two things together. So I have symbol of fk minus 1, tensor phi, and that same sum over phi's. And then I feed this definition back into itself and compute the symbol of the fk minus 1's, and eventually I'll go down to a k-tuple, a sum over k-tuples, in this space of rational functions. Phi 1 tensor all the way up to phi k, that's the weight k. These phi's are all drawn from this same set of rational functions that I called alphabet now. So we call the phi's letters and the set of them an alphabet. And there will be coefficients for each k-tuple, which is denoted by this c sub vector phi. These are just some rational coefficients for each term in this possible expansion. And this we can think of this as being a word in these letters. There's a linear combination of k-tuples, is some word in the letters of my alphabet. And it's not any old word, because I should ensure that through my definition, which was differential, I should ensure that partial derivatives still commute on this object. And to do that, what I have to do is pick up any sequential pair of letters and evaluate explicitly d log phi I wedge d log phi I plus one, and then sum over the rest of the symbol with its coefficients, and that should vanish. This is just a consequence that if I apply d squared onto my function, two applications of the exterior derivative should vanish. This implies this relation, which is why I called it integrability.
Sorry, James, do you have an algebraic structure?
And what's nice about this symbol object is it encodes simultaneously the differential properties through the definition. That's how I introduced it. So if I apply d, by convention, it's acting on the right. I pulled off this d log phi on the right. So if I apply an exterior derivative, it acts on the rightmost letter and gives me d log.
So James.
But it also simultaneously gives me the discontinuities of the function, the branch cut structure of the function. And to do that, I just read off the leftmost letter of each word. So if I want to know the discontinuity around some place in my space described by, let's say, phi 1 equals 0, there's some rational function vanishing, gives me some slice in my space, the discontinuity around that, well, every element that begins with phi one, I just strip off the phi one and replace it by 2 pi i, because there's a logarithm sitting there. Okay, and then if it doesn't begin with phi one, I get zero contribution from that. So what's nice about this is you can simultaneously record the differential and the branch cut properties. Okay, so the key point was that the choice of alphabet of letters defines the class of functions that we're interested in. So what is the set, the alphabet, that's relevant for our scattering amplitudes on this Grassmannian space? This is the question. And in the hexagon case, the first 6-point case, the letters are nothing other than those minors that I introduced before, the four brackets IJKL. So the symbol will just look like a sequence of four bracket, tensor, four bracket, tensor, four bracket, all the way along, up to weight 2L for the L loop amplitude, and a linear combination of such things. And how many of these are there? Well, there are 15 because I've got 6 labels and I've got to put 4 in the bracket, and it's anti-symmetric. So 6 choose 4 is 15. And then I should remember I'm projective. So I've got 6 scalings, one for each label to mod out by. So I've got to subtract 6. Ultimately, there are 9 homogeneous combinations of these brackets, letters, rational functions of our variables, and these will be the letters, the singularities appearing in these polylogarithms.
So, James,
I can't hear. Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Am I?
I hear you now.
Okay, sorry. I'm wondering, do you have an algebraic structure on those functions that you were using?
So you're asking where do these letters come from?
Well, yes, is there a closed algebra? It looks like you might define an algebra and perhaps a co-algebra and some other structure.
Oh, okay, very good. Yes, so I'm going to come to... Where they appear from is going to be related to these cluster algebras. That's okay. What I'm actually going to come to in a minute.
Okay.
So I hope this will answer your question. If it doesn't, please ask again.
Sure.
And maybe I should also just emphasize that, remember, at the very beginning, I was still talking about momenta. Like everything was just changes of variables in the first instance to describe the Grassmannian. So these Zs, they're all functions of momenta. So these funny things that I've written down with numbers sitting in them, 1, 2, 3, 6, and so on, these are all just crazy looking functions of momenta, right? Some bunch of Mandelstams and square roots of Mandelstams and so on and so on. But honest momentum functions, which are going to describe the locations of singularities of my scattering amplitude. Okay, I'm just using the nicest notation to describe them. Okay, good. So let's come to these cluster algebras now. So what is the general answer to this question? Where do these letters come from? We just said they're minors in the hexagon case. More generally, they will be dictated by cluster algebras associated to the Grassmannian GR4M. So what are cluster algebras? Well, there's a kind of formal definition, which is slightly opaque in its meaning. They're commutative algebras with distinguished set of generators called cluster variables. The variables are grouped into overlapping sets called clusters, and then you can get from one cluster to another by a process called mutation. Okay, so far so good. But what they are really is they are a beautiful way of generating natural coordinates for an underlying geometrical space. So that's what these variables really are. They're interesting, useful coordinates on an underlying geometrical space. And for us, the space will be a particular region of the Grassmannian space that we're interested in, so-called positive region, where all our minors are positive. So it's better to do an example to see how these things work. So let me just do a simple example, a two-dimensional example. It's not one of my GR4N. This is a simpler one. It's GR25. So the cluster variables will be labeled by AM. The initial cluster will be a pair of them, A1 and A2. And then sequential clusters will be adjacent pairs, AM, AM plus 1. And then this mutation relation tells me how I get from one cluster to the next cluster. And to do that, I just have to tell you how do I define the variable am plus 1 in terms of the preceding variables? And it's going to be given by this rule, 1 plus am over am minus 1. Just take this rule for granted for now. We'll come back to it. Let's see what happens. So I have a1, a2. I must compute a3. Easy. 1 plus a2 over a1. Done. What about a4? Well, that's 1 plus a3 over a2. So if I do 1 plus a3 over a2, I will actually get this factor 1 plus a1 plus a2 in the numerator for a4. And then I should divide by a1, a2. Okay. What about a5? Now some magic happens. I have 1 plus a4 over a3. So if I do 1 plus a4, you see I'm going to factorize the numerator. It's going to give me 1 plus a1 times 1 plus a2. And then I have to divide by, a3, so I'll cancel the factor 1 plus a2. And I'll also simultaneously cancel that factor a1 from the denominator. So it simplifies again, and I get back to 1 plus a1 over a2 for a5. And then I go again, I go to a6, that's 1 plus a5 over a4. And now you'll find that I cancel the complicated factor, 1 plus a1 plus a2 from a4. And in fact, the resulting answer for a6 is just a1 again. And a7 is just a2 again. And I'm done. I go round 5 times and I come back to where I started. So I actually find that the topology of the mutations in this example is just a pentagon. I've got 5 clusters. Each cluster has 2 variables and they label the edges of this pentagon, the faces more generally, but edges in this pentagon example. Each cluster is a corner and there are just 5 of them. Okay, so that was a beginning example. More generally, we can describe them with quiver diagrams. So what do? I draw a quiver diagram with nodes and arrows, and each node corresponds to a cluster variable. And then what I have to do is describe the mutation operation. So here's the rule. If I pick a node K, then whenever I have an arrow coming into that node, and another arrow going out, then I adjoin an extra arrow from I to J. So if I have I goes into K out to J, I put I to J, a new arrow. Then I reverse all the arrows to and from K. And if I have opposing arrows like so that are left over, then I cancel them, just delete them. And also returning arrows if that happens. And then finally, I have to tell you what I do to the variable. How do I get the new variable on node K? Well, that's just 1 over the old variable times the product over the incoming guys plus the product over the outgoing guys. Okay. So there's a rule for a quiver diagram. Let's do our example, our two-dimensional example again. So in this example, I just have 2 nodes and an arrow connecting them. And then if I mutate on node 1, what do I get? I get the rule for A3, which is A1 prime. And what does it tell me? I have to do 1 over A1. And then I've got the product over all incoming arrows. Well, there are no incoming arrows on node 1. So I just get 1 for that product. And then I have to add to that the product over all outgoing arrows. Well, there's only 1 outgoing arrow and it goes to 2. So I get A2 for the outgoing product. So indeed, for A3, I just get 1 plus A2 over A1. So we can relate back that rule that I just handed to you on the previous slide. It corresponds to this rule to do with quivers and arrows that I gave in a more general form on this slide. And what's interesting about these cluster algebras, in that example I gave you, it was clearly finite. I did 5 hops and I got back to where I started. And oftentimes these things are finite, but also very often, many times, more generally, they're not finite. You start mutating, you mutate, 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 and you just go on forever generating more and more complicated looking cluster variables, infinitely many possible clusters. Okay, so this is obviously quite a general notion, and it has these interesting features of sometimes being closed and sometimes not being closed. Now, we can actually associate to the Grassmannian a cluster algebra. And the one I gave was actually an example of a Grassmannian cluster algebra. I said it was GR25, but I didn't justify that. Let me show you what happens if I look at the cluster algebras for GR4n, which is the case of our kinematic space for four-dimensional massless scattering. So the initial variables will be given by a specified set of these Grassmannian four brackets, these minors, Pooka variables, I, J, K, L. And they will sit on nodes of a complicated looking quiver diagram where I have these columns and rows for my initial quiver and arrows joined in the way shown on the diagram. And you'll notice that there are some special nodes in boxes. These just mean some of these nodes you never mutate on. Those are called frozen nodes, and I never want to mutate on those. The other nodes I can mutate on, and they're called active nodes. And now what happens is, in general, when I mutate, I will generate other minors, or more generally, polynomials in minors. They're not always minors that I generate. Sometimes I get polynomials in minors. Okay, and I will generally call these polynomials in minors, I'll call them A coordinates, following some notation from the mathematical literature, which is not always self-consistent, but never mind. So these polynomials that I generate via this operation of mutation, I will call A coordinates. Oh, and by the way, it's non-trivial that they're polynomials, because you remember in the definition I had a denominator, I had to divide. But in the Grassmannian, these minors, Pooka variables, they satisfy Pooka identities, some quadratic relations. Basically, if I try to anti-symmetrize on five labels, I can't, because I've only got four in a determinant. So if I that will give me some quadratic relations amongst these minors. Using those, it turns out you can always cancel the denominator. So you never get rational functions in minors, you only get polynomials in minors by doing this mutation relation. Okay, now these were connected to amplitudes in n equals four by the authors in green here. By looking at some known two-loop results, whose singularities were all iterated integrals of the form that I showed you before, and the letters, the symbol letters, were all of the form of these cluster A coordinates.
Okay. Can I ask how you determine the arrows in for GR4n?
So if I hand you this quiver as is, then the mutation relation tells you how to determine how all the arrows go for every cluster. Why you end up with this particular diagram for the initial cluster, this is just one choice, but this is something that was found by the people I cited at the top, Fomin, Zelivinsky and Scott. And so on, they associated this particular quiver diagram to these Grassmannian cluster algebras.
So that's your seed, and then there are many different diagrams which will reproduce what you want?
Absolutely, so yeah, exactly. I could start with another quiver diagram, but the way I've written it this way is uniform for GR4n. And actually, if I'd added more rows, it would be uniform for GRKn. So there's one particular nice class of clusters which I can write down for you in general. But then to get all the others, I must do the mutation operation, and I get many other different looking clusters from this one. If your question was more about why is this a natural thing, why is this quiver diagram and cluster algebra a natural thing to associate to the Grassmannian, I hope I will address that when I talk about the tropical property as well. So let me just pause on that question slightly until we get to the tropical geometry. I hope, though, I did get to answer Denjo's question by now, which was what's the algebraic structure which provides these rational functions for us. Okay, so all right, good. So here's just a beautiful mathematical thing that's been handed to us. We apply it, we generate this list of singularities, and we build all these iterated integral functions. So what happens in our lowest example, in the hexagon case, GR46? So then I have this quiver diagram on the left. I start in some cluster, and then what happens is, in this case, the topology of mutations is the thing on the right. I get a polytope called the Stashev polytope. It has, each corner is a cluster, just like the corners of our pentagon. And in fact, it contains the pentagons. You can see some pentagons in the picture. They are exactly subalgebras of the type that I showed you before. So this initial cluster, I think, corresponds to the corner on the top left of the sort of exterior octagon, if you see on the picture. And the active nodes in the column on the left, they are the faces that meet at that corner. So you should see 1, 2, 3, 5 is the pentagon at the top front. 1, 2, 4, 5 is the square on the left, and 1, 3, 4, 5 is the pentagon at the back on the left in the picture. And then I mutate, and this is the topology of mutations. And again, it closes. There are 14 corners or clusters and 9 faces, which means 9 active nodes, as well as the 6 frozen ones, which I never touch. And so you find that mutation indeed generates all 15 of the minors available to you in the Grassmannian GR46. And it arranges them into this nice here it is coming back from the cluster algebra. But we can go beyond.
So where is 1, 2, 3, 4 in that picture?
So 1, 2, 3, 4. So the frozen nodes are not on the picture. It only labels the unfrozen nodes. Every cluster has all 6 frozen nodes as well associated to it, but they're not labeled. Because I never touch those, so they're always there in every cluster. Okay, good. Excellent. So now let's go to the next case, GR47. So now here we find that if you do this operation, you start with minors, you do all the mutations, you get all 35 possible minors, that's 7 choose 4. And in addition, you get 14 quadratics. Remember, I said you can get polynomials as well as just minors. And these get arranged in a 6-dimensional polytope with 833 clusters. And it's hard to draw, but you can draw it on Mathematica. It looks like that. Not very revealing, but you can draw it. It's finite again, though. That's what I want to get to. But the crucial thing is, therefore, we know what letters we should expect for 7 particle scattering. So we should get these 49 polynomials, A coordinates, that we got, including 14 quadratics, in homogeneous combinations. So I should now subtract 7. So I get 42 homogeneous letters given by these A's here and their cyclic cousins. And you'll see that they contain the A5 and the A6 type letters contain these quadratics that are written at the bottom here. Okay, now this cluster algebra, if I drop the frozen nodes, it looks like the picture on the left in the initial cluster. But after a sequence of mutations, you can turn it into the picture on the right. And this identifies it actually with an E6 cluster algebra. So this is just one example of different types of shapes of cluster that you can get starting with a given Grassmannian cluster algebra. But this identifies it with E6 and hence it's finite. If you find a Dinkin diagram of a finite dimensional Lie algebra, your cluster should be finite. Cluster algebra should be finite. Okay, now we get a bonus. So we know that singularities in scattering amplitudes are not all independent of each other. In particular, one relation which shows you that this cannot be the case is the Steinman relations. If you take a discontinuity in one channel, and then you try and take a discontinuity in an overlapping channel, you should find you can't do it. There should be no discontinuity of the discontinuity in an overlapping channel. I'm just thinking of an ordinary two-particle unitarity cut. So some Mandelstam vanishes, and then I try and make a Mandelstam that's made up of incompatible sets of legs, and I try and take that discontinuity, and your amplitude should not have such a discontinuity. Okay, now what does that translate to? In our bracket notation, this would be something like 1, 2, 4, 5, which would actually correspond to, it would correspond to, it would correspond to P3 plus P4 plus P5 all squared. So it would be a long Mandelstam invariant for six particle scattering, and then a rotated one. So that's a crossing channel, right? A long Mandelstam and then a crossed one. That would be 2, 3, 5, 6. And you'll see they correspond to the square faces on the polytope, and the square faces don't intersect on the boundary of the polytope. So this polytope already knows something about Steinman relations. It says there are faces that don't intersect. So faces that don't intersect should not be allowed as sequential discontinuities. Well, that suggests there's more. You can go and look and check if I do 1, 2, 4, 5, but then 1, 3, 5, 6, which corresponds to one of these pentagonal faces, then I shouldn't be allowed this sequence of discontinuities either. And indeed you aren't. They don't show up in the results for the amplitudes. Same for 1, 3, 4, 5 and 2, 4, 5, 6, corresponding to two disjoint pentagonal faces. And this is actually true, not just for the unitarity cuts, like I said, which would be the first two entries of the symbol. Remember, monodromies act on the left. So if I take a cut, I'm looking at the leftmost entry. If I take another cut, I'm looking at the second leftmost entry.
So James, I'm confused. Are you inspecting the geometry to get these, or was there some rule that you used to write down these Steinman
relations? So the Steinman relations come from considering discontinuities of amplitudes, and that's quite an old thing from the 60s. And so on. Here I'm interpreting a little bit because we're doing massless scattering. So you have to think a little bit about what it means for these massless scattering amplitudes, and that was much more recent. And I was not expecting the geometry to necessarily encode this. This was something that came out. Once we had the geometry to hand, we can observe that it does encode. That Steinman violation, or the Steinman condition, corresponds to having faces that don't intersect on the boundary of this polytope.
So you are writing down these relations, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, tensor, etc., because you know those are historical.
Exactly.
And you are checking the geometry.
Exactly, exactly. I'm showing something that was known, and you can see it on the geometry. But now I'm showing you something that was not known, and you can also see the same thing on the geometry.
Okay.
To do with these pentagonal faces and their relations to each other. But it's true. You go and look at the results, and you look everywhere in the symbol, not just the first two entries, but anywhere. So in other words, any sequential pairs of discontinuities of any discontinuity you care to take, you will find that you cannot have 1, 3, 5, 6 after 1, 2, 4, 5. Or 2, 4, 5, 6 after 1, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so there's a rule that holds universally, true everywhere in the symbol. So this led us to this cluster adjacency principle. It says consecutive discontinuities around unfrozen nodes, A coordinates, due to unfrozen nodes, are forbidden unless they intersect on the boundary. Okay, so if they label separated faces, such pairs are forbidden. And it rather suggests both the fact that the singularities themselves and the relationships between them are encoded in this cluster algebra, that there's actually some algebraic geometric picture behind the analytic structure of these amplitudes. Okay, so that's one direction I want to head in. I also just want to point out on a practical level, you can use all these properties now, and we have, and many people have, and there's an ongoing program of constructing results for scattering amplitudes based on guessing their singularities, constructing the integrable words in that symbol alphabet, constraining with various physical properties, physical branch cut conditions, collinear limits, Steinman relations, adjacency, these kinds of things. And then in that space, you find that you can just pick out the only thing that satisfies all these conditions, and you can declare that's my amplitude. So this allows you to construct things, quite complicated things. For example, you can fix up to four loop heptagon amplitudes this way, without having to write down any integrals or construct any integrand. You're just immediately aiming at the integrated answer because you think you know what space of functions it lives in.
So excuse me, so you're not using the fact, the structure of the Yang-Mills theory or whatever, or the planar, even the planar structure of it, right? These are just...
So I am secretly using the planar structure because that was, I think that was encoded in my definition of my kinematic variables to begin with.
Yes, of course.
Twisters. Yeah. And it picks out a particular region of the Grassmannian. So these pictures here, it looks like it's not just a topology of mutations. The inside of this polytope is the real three-dimensional kinematic space, right? This is a map of the kinematic space, but it's a particular region of it called the positive region. So on the inside of this, all the minors are positive. That's the defining property of this polytope. There's a special region in kinematic space where all my minors are positive, and it has this beautiful boundary structure, and the boundary structure of that region encodes all these singularities and the relationships between them. Okay.
So would this apply to other planar theories? I mean, it wouldn't have to be Yang-Mills, or
so
I could look at it.
I did use dual conformal symmetry. So okay. Here, now I do believe that we can relax that and talk about other planar theories, and things are more complicated and things are known to lower multiplicity. But this general program of bootstrapping, and once you know analytic properties, this will work whatever. If as long, all I need to know is what are my singularities? And what's missing in other theories so far is the analog of the geometric construction that I'm sort of halfway through presenting, which gave for us what these singularities were and their relations. So I do believe that there will be an analog of this for more general, let's say, pure Yang-Mills theory, say, where I don't have the dual conformal symmetry, or even non-planar n equals 4. That's another interesting case. Okay, good. So I'm not going to say more about the bootstraps. There's lots of stuff there written that we can discuss more if you like. But I want to focus on a puzzle now. So I showed you that for the hexagon case, we had this nice shape and 9 letters arising because of the 9 faces, basically. And for the heptagon, I showed you this nasty shape, but it was still a shape. And really, it's a nice shape once you know how to handle it. It's just hard to draw. It's 6-dimensional now. But when you go to the octagon, you find that you're in the case of cluster algebras that don't close. So now if I do the analogous thing for GR48, I start with my initial cluster, I mutate. I can mutate, keep mutating, 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 and I develop a list of infinitely many possible singularities. And I don't close onto some finite, nice shape. So how can that be? That doesn't make sense, because a given perturbative amplitude does have finitely many singularities. So how do we resolve this? So that's going to motivate this next section, which is thinking about tropical geometry. And I just want to come back to the Grassmannian and make explicit something I mentioned before, which is that if we write down these Plucker coordinates, these minors, IJKL, they obey these quadratic relations, Plucker relations. So if I try to anti-symmetrize on 5 labels, this vanishes because there are only 4 component objects. So I get quadratic relations amongst these minors. Now I actually want to think about these relations as the defining property of the Grassmannian. Let me just simply replace these minors. Let me not think of them as the minors of some matrix. Let me just give them a name, PIJKL, some variable, P. And use these relations to define my space in the space of P's. This is called the Plucker embedding. So here are the Plucker relations written out again. They're quadratic relations on my variables P, and they define an ideal, Plucker ideal, in the space of polynomials in my variables P. Now I want to do something that's quite brutal. I want to pass to the tropical Grassmannian. So what does tropicalization mean? On an operational level here, it means replacing a multiplication of variables with addition. and replacing addition of variables with the minimum. Okay, now this looks like a slightly odd thing, but it does actually obey lots of the rules of a field. It doesn't obey all the rules of a field. In fact, it's a semi-field because, obviously addition is no longer an invertible operation, right? But apart from that, we get lots of rules. It obeys the distributivity law of multiplication and addition. That still holds. So as an example, what do I do to get a tropical polynomial? So here's a random polynomial I've just written down, xy plus wz squared plus 2uv. So I replace addition with minimum, so I get a minimum over three terms. And then in each term, I replace multiplication with addition. So the first term's x plus y. The second term is w plus 2z, because it was wz squared. And the third term is just u plus v. And notice I lost the coefficient in that last term. I lost the 2. All right, so what happens is that in my tropical version of the polynomial, this is now a piecewise linear function on the space. Okay, depending on which of the arguments is the minimum at a given point, then I get that linear function on the space. So a tropical polynomial chops your space up into regions of linearity.
Do you impose positivity on the x and y after and multiplication?
I don't have to impose positivity, I don't think. And indeed, I'm going to lose information about the sign. Maybe that's what you're worried about. So I lost a 2. I would have lost a minus 1 as well.
Yeah, no, I'm just observing that it looks like you're going to the modulus of the logarithm of the modulus.
It's very close to the logarithm, but beware that I've got this minimum operation. So it's not going to be, it's very much like d log, or it's very close to an algebra of d logarithmic forms, but it's not quite because of this minimum operation. I mean, what's really happening, what you really do to get this is you don't treat the variables themselves. You actually do like you do when you compute a Grobner basis. You rescale each variable with some parameter to a power associated to that variable. So I replace x with x times t to, I don't know, its variable, x tilde, say, let's call the power on t, x tilde. And y with y times t to the power y tilde. And then I consider the leading terms in t as I take t small, right? That will chop, depending on the relative strengths of x tilde and y tilde and w tilde and so on, that will select for me which term is the leading power. So this will give me this an equivalent way of arriving at this minimum operation. But however you get there, the tropical version of the polynomial divides your space up into regions of piecewise linearity, and those regions are separated by walls or hypersurfaces in your space. And what's interesting about this operation is that the tropical space actually captures many features of the original space that you're working with, your original Grassmannian in our case. So let me just do GR46 and take the tropical version. Here's a Plucker relation that I've written down with three terms. And below it is the tropical version with its minimum. And you'll see that I've got three terms, minimum, each term has a sum of Pluckers in, and I've lost the minus sign. So how do I figure out when I'm on a hypersurface? So to be on a hypersurface, I should be between two distinct regions of linearity. So that means that two of the arguments in the minimum should actually be equal to each other and less than the other one, because it's got to be the minimum. So this gives me three possibilities listed below for finding these tropical hypersurfaces. And I can recover that information about the sign by insisting that in my equality, the things that I'm going to make equal will be terms that came with opposite sign from my original relation. Okay, so This will admit the first possibility and the last possibility, but not the middle possibility. So I can recover some information due to lost signs by this insistence. And indeed, that's what I want to do, because I actually want to consider the positive tropical Grassmannian. Okay, so I'm going to just admit the first and the last solution here. Or an alternative way of doing this was given by Spire and Williams. I'll just choose coordinates and solve the Plucker relations. Okay, so I'll pick some x coordinates for my momentum twister variables. And now the Pluckers will just become polynomials in these coordinates. Okay, and now I will tropicalize these polynomials in some coordinates that I've picked, and then look at the tropical hypersurface conditions on these polynomials. And what happens when I do this is I'm going to obtain a fan with vertices, edges, and triangles. In this GR46 case, it looks like this. You can see I've got a three-dimensional space, and I slice my space along the planes, the axis planes. Those are the three gray circles. And then I've got a kind of yellow semicircle and a red semicircle and a blue wedge. And they intersect in some complicated arrangement of slices. And between each of these slices, I'm in a cone over a triangle. And that's a region of piecewise linearity for all of the minors simultaneously. Now, if I take the dual of this picture, I recover this picture, which we saw before, this Stashev polytope. So this tropical geometry is actually capturing the same combinatorics that the cluster algebra gave for us. So this is another route via kinematics to arrive at the same combinatorial structure to do with the, that we also saw from the cluster algebra. And you will see that on the left, I've isolated where the planes intersect with each other. I've drawn these black dots. So I've intersected with the unit sphere. And then on the unit sphere where the planes intersect each other, I've drawn black dots. So these are special directions called rays, or vertices, really, if I think about them on the unit sphere. And these vertices are connected with edges, and then the edges connect up into triangles. And then in this example, I stopped because I've only got that many dimensions. But in higher dimensional examples, I could go up to tetrahedra and higher dimensional symplices and so on, right? Which I would do in my E6 example, for example. And on the right now, I've labeled the faces with the rays that they are dual to on the left. So each face now is labeled by a ray. And these rays also have a cluster algebraic interpretation. There's another thing that also follows through in the mutation operation, which is called a G vector. And this is very simple. I just put a unit vector in each of the directions on each node of my initial cluster. And there's an equivalent mutation rule for these, which I've not bothered to write down, but it's related to how you express new A coordinates in terms of old ones. And so I've got a one-to-one correspondence between G vectors and A coordinates, just according to which cluster and which node they sit on. And for our example that I showed before, this one, the rays that we get from this tropical geometry are equal to, they are the G vectors coming from the cluster algebra. So the cluster algebra and the tropical geometry are really very closely connected. They really provide the same set of data as each other. Okay, and so in fact, in this case, we can say this Spire-Williams fan for the tropical Grassmannian is equal to the cluster G vector fan. So these two fans are the same. However, things get more interesting when you go to other cases because you get choices that you can make. You can choose different things to tropicalize. You can also tropicalize the quadratic A coordinates as well as the minors. Remember in GR47 we had quadratics. And if I pick coordinates, these quadratics will also be polynomials in my coordinates, and I can tropicalize them too. And in fact, there's a sort of set of four natural fans that you might consider. The second one on the list is the Spire-Williams fan, where you tropicalize all the minors. The bottom one on the list is where you tropicalize all the A coordinates, and that's equivalent to the cluster G vector fan in this case. So in this case, the Speyer-Williams construction and the cluster fan are actually different. They share the same set of rays, because all of these fans have 42 rays. That's the leftmost number in what I've labeled F vector for the fan here. They have the same set of rays, but you'll see they don't all have the same edge structure. That's the second column. The cluster fan, the 399, those are all the intersections of faces on the cluster polytope. So those are the cluster adjacent allowed pairs. But some of these fans have fewer allowed adjacencies, and they have different numbers of triangles and so on. So you get these different choices of what you can associate to the Grassmannian. And in fact, from what we know so far, the MHV amplitudes actually seem to like the top fan on the list, the least refined fan. And NMHV amplitudes seem to like the third fan on the list, which is not all the way to the cluster fan. Okay, but this is based on low loop data. So these are tentative statements that we don't may only hold for low loops. But nevertheless, there seems to be a choice of fans, and now the game is which is the right fan to describe your scattering amplitude. Okay, now I'm conscious that I'm really at the end of my time. So I have another section which is aimed at answering that puzzle that we discussed before, but I'm just going to go to the punchline.
We're not sticklers for time, James.
Okay, well, I mean, I'm happy to go on further, but I don't want to keep you for hours and hours. So maybe it's better if I try and summarize, and then if you want to discuss more and ask questions, I'm happy to discuss more of the material in more detail. But, okay. Now, remember our puzzle. We want to go to octagons and higher, 8-point amplitudes and higher. We had these infinite cluster algebras. So we need a way to select a finite number of A coordinates. And there's also a second puzzle, which I didn't say before, but we also know that there are some letters, some singularities that aren't rational, cannot be A coordinates, because remember, the A coordinates always produced for us polynomials in minors. That's a general feature. So there are some singularities that are going to be missing, and there are way too many, infinitely too many. So let me just focus on the second point temporarily. We already know at one loop for 8-particle scattering that there are some non-rational singularities, because the good old 4-mass box integral has this quadratic that needs to be solved. I've got U and V are cross ratios in minors. But the letters are x and x bar and 1 minus x and 1 minus x bar. So if I solve these quadratic relations that come from these equations here, I will find square roots of things involving polynomials in minors as the singularities. And this is already present in the n squared MHV amplitude at one loop, 8-point amplitude, where I put 2 massless particles on each corner, so they add up to be like a massive particle. Okay, and then I've got the 4-mass box. It's a very simple, well-known integral, and it doesn't have these rational singularities. It has algebraic ones. So how are we going to address these two problems? Well, the tropical fan tells us how to address the first one, because now I can always pick a tropical fan where I tropicalize finitely many A coordinates, maybe all the minors, or maybe a subset of the minors, or maybe the minors and their parity conjugates. These are the three examples that I've got listed here. Okay, remember again, these minors are just some polynomials in some choice of coordinates, and I tropicalize them using the tropicalization rule. So if I do that, then I find finitely many rays. I have to, because I've got finitely many conditions to solve. So I only have finitely many walls, and they intersect in finitely many special directions. For example, in the simplest fan on the top here, I find 274 rays, like the analogues of those black dots that I showed you for the GR46 example. There are 274 of them in this example. And moreover, 272 of them we can identify with G vectors of the cluster algebra, because we know how to generate them. We've got a rule for generating them, and we just match them up. But, of course, there are two others. And we call these extra rays or limit rays. And in fact, these extra guys generate for us also the algebraic singularities. Okay, and now the thing that I was going to tell you next was how that happens. But let me just say in words what happens. So we have infinitely many clusters that we can generate, and therefore infinitely many A coordinates. But these extra special rays that we have here, we can actually identify them as limits of infinite sequences of G vectors. Special infinite sequences of G vectors. And in fact, we can even solve explicitly for the infinite sequences that end on these rays, we can solve explicitly a formula for generating their A coordinates. And in fact, it's really very nice. This is a picture that just shows you that this should be identified with an affine example. And it boils down to this picture at the bottom. And the thing that makes it infinite is you have a doubled arrow. Okay, things with doubled arrows have this affine structure and hence infinitely many mutations that you can do. Okay, and there's some sort of sequences of infinite sequences of mutations. Let me just skip to the formula. So you find something that looks like a Fibonacci relation. And you can solve the Fibonacci relation, and here's the explicit solution at the top. Okay, so we get things that involve square roots coming out, because in the square root is there because of that doubled arrow. Okay, so the mutation relation has a quadratic form to it. And because of that, you can you find quadratics appearing in your mutation relation. And because of that, you get you can relate that to this Fibonacci type recurrence, and you know Fibonacci and the golden ratio can be solved by a generating sequence. So this is completely analogous just to the good old Fibonacci numbers, except that now we've got coefficients which are polynomials in our variables. So we have functional coefficients dependent on our variables. But otherwise, it's completely analogous to the Fibonacci sequence. And so the solution is given in terms of things involving square roots, which is the analog of the golden ratio for Fibonacci. And importantly, in this example, we get coefficients as well as the golden ratio, which is something like this P plus root delta that shows up. We get coefficients, which are Z0 plus BZ root delta. I've highlighted in red. Okay, these are just some functions of the variables that we can generate with our cluster algebra. So these are some explicit expressions, ultimately in terms of momenta. And we can identify these coefficients with new letters. So what happens is that for a given ray, one of these extra rays, we find many sequences which asymptote towards it. Actually, we find for each ray, we find 64 sequences that asymptote towards it. So we get 64 solutions for these sequences. The P plus root delta is universal. Everybody has that. The bit in red depends on the path of approach. Now, if I just look at the pieces in red, we find, well, first of all, let me say that the root delta turns out to be exactly on the nose, the four mass box square root function. So this is a huge clue that these things are indeed, these limit rays are special, and they're telling us something about the four mass box singularities. Okay, but more, even more interestingly than that, the red things, which basically give us these ratios, phi z and phi w, I've written at the top, those coefficients are not, they're not all multiplicatively independent, but a lot of them are independent. In fact, 18 are independent, and they match explicitly the 18 letters that show up in a two-loop NMHV calculation done by the authors in green at the bottom. So we find, and I'm sorry that this last piece was a little quick, and I'm happy to fill out the details, but the punchline is that if we combine the idea of taking a tropical fan with the cluster algebra together, we can find not only a finite set of singularities in this infinite dimensional cluster algebra, which are picked by our tropical fan, but also amongst them, a list of algebraic singularities, which include exactly the singularities that we needed for this two loop NMHV scattering amplitude. So we sort of, both problems are solved simultaneously by the combination of the cluster algebra and the tropical geometry. Okay, so that's the summary. I more or less told you the punchline that I wanted to share, which is that this combination, well, we've identified the Grassmannian for the kinematics. There's a cluster algebra that goes with the Grassmannian to tell us the singularities of our iterated integrals. The tropical Grassmannian, positive tropical Grassmannian, is directly connected to that same cluster algebra. But once we've got the tropical notion, we have different choices that we can make. We don't have to pick the cluster fan, we can pick something a bit less refined. And that's important because when we go to 8 points, we want it to not have infinitely many singularities. So we can pick something that's finite instead of infinite. And moreover, when we do so, we get extra data, and paths leading to these extra rays should be identified with algebraic singularities. So we get to fix both the infinity and the algebraic problem. And okay, and here's a long list of interesting questions that take us far off into the future for things that we can try and exploit and understand better in this story. But I'm conscious that I've gone on far too long. So let me stop here. And then if anybody has questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Well, let's thank James. We tend to be silent thinkers. So.
No problem.
This format doesn't lead to thinking so easily. Well, thank you for a tour through tropical forests of geometry.
Sure.
Various other topics.
No problem.
And that lets open the floor to questions. Bernard looks like he's ready.
Yes. Well, actually, firstly, thank you, and then I've many questions. One question is, how much is still experimental? So. Mm. You seem to have a lot of choices still on the way, a finite number, but still it's not so clear how to go on from.
Very much agree with that question. A lot of it is experimental. We are trying to find what are the rules of the game to associate a given tropical geometry to a given amplitude. And it's not clear, even in the finite case, I said, for example, here I was talking about GR47. Here, I gave a list of four possible tropical fans. And in this case, all singularities, the 42 singularities, they are all the same for each of these fans. But the edge structure is not the same. And in fact, up to four loops for MHV amplitudes, we only see these, actually, I think we even see fewer, the 385 in the second column at the top. We only see those adjacency relations in the symbol. That's experimental. We know that up to four loops, we don't know what happens at five loops. Will it continue? And likewise for the NMHV amplitude, we see all 399 possible edge relations, but we don't see all the triangles. So we don't need to go to the 1547 in the bottom of the third column for NMHV amplitudes so far. So, these are statements that are certainly experimental up to four loops. And we don't know a priori why we should pick the top fan or the third fan or indeed the bottom fan for a given seven particle amplitude. We just see that they're consistent. But there, the 8-point example is a strong clue that this is something along the right lines, because we know we should get something finite for a given loop order in perturbation theory. And we've seen that it provides for us the algebraic singularities. So we are trying to unify this picture into something that tells us what is the right fan for a given amplitude. And in fact, we want to go further. Once we understand the geometry, we want to know what's the question whose answer is actually the amplitude. Now, what geometrical quantity does the amplitude evaluate? And we don't know the answer to that yet either. Instead, we're sort of at a halfway stage where we can use these properties to construct new results by this bootstrap type game, where you make an ansatz, impose the properties and some additional physical requirements you want, and then that isolates for you a given result for an amplitude. And that's extremely useful, but it's not all the way to answering your question of what's the underlying geometrical rules of the game and where do they come from.
Well, I just wanted to know which stage you're in, and you're discovering some new mathematics. And my second question is, are there already indications of what the mathematics will be? I only know the very beginning, the Pentagon stuff and the relations there. That's algebraic K-theory, precisely K3. And I know that Goncharov was going on in some direction to the higher K-groups or so. Is there some overlap between what he's interested in and what you are doing?
On that level, I don't know. Maybe. What I suspect is, well, certainly these things are related to some underlying geometry. And we've seen these Grassmannians showing up here. What I suspect is, in the general case, that we should be thinking of the tropical kinematic space more generally. And it was just in this example, it was a very nice space, this Grassmannian. But we can write down a kinematic ideal for general massless scattering, and we can tropicalize that, and we'll get some structure. And what we don't have for the general case is the analog of the cluster algebra. So what is the algebraic thing which is going to provide for us the information about singularities for a given space? And what I suspect may be going on is that we're going to have to go back to the theory of Grobner bases for the underlying geometric space and understand the structure of the Grobner fan and relate this to this tropical geometry. And then there should be some cluster algebraic analog for moving around in the Grobner fan. I don't know how that might relate to this story of K-theory, but there are certainly lots of interesting mathematical directions to explore.
I just would think it would be useful to talk to mathematicians who are maybe able to see structure which you can't. The way, yeah. You work very elementary with very elementary concepts.
Absolutely.
And people who are doing number theory of or block group stuff and so on, they just might be able to see something more.
Well, yes, I mean, we have been discussing with mathematicians, there are many workshops where mathematicians are involved, and people who study in cluster algebras and so on, they get excited, but so far they don't, they haven't sort of cracked what should be. I think even this story about the algebraic letters, there's some stuff in the mathematics literature about finding algebraic square root structures associated to these affine things. So that's not new. But what was new, I think, was just the simple Fibonacci style solution for the explicit formula for the A coordinates. I never saw that. So this seemed to be new when I spoke to the people who'd been studying this. And that was key to identifying these. What's interesting about it is it's not just the limit. You see, you have to consider the path to the limit. And you have to record how you get to the limit. So actually, I think this is a clue also how to go beyond, because when you go beyond 8 points, you get to a case that's beyond affine. You go to this wild case. And in the wild case, you actually get gaps. So in the affine case, I can just consider a two-dimensional example. In the affine case, what happens is you get a sequence of G vectors that asymptote, all eventually pointing to the same direction. Okay, you can imagine just in affine shifting along one direction, right, off to infinity. And then these G vectors, they asymptote, and in both directions, they asymptote to the same overall direction, which is our limit ray that I was describing very briefly. But that gives us a limit ray. But there's no gap between. So the cluster algebra covers everything except for the actual line that's going, you sort of this affine limit line. But when we go beyond, we actually get gaps. There's a whole wedge of stuff that the cluster algebra doesn't access. And so I think this idea of keeping the limit, it might be related to the idea of blowing up that gap, treating that gap as not just a line and a limit itself, but you should remember it's a gap. And so to get to the gap, you should remember how you got there. Say, because in higher examples, you actually have a gap, and then you have a boundary on the gap,
yeah,
that's blown up for you. So anyway, so I mean, certainly mathematicians have studied those examples.
It looked a little bit like a Paddy approximant trying to approximate a cut by many points or so.
That's an interesting idea. Yes, so I haven't thought about it that way. I mean, certainly. Well, look, we have an explicit solution. But what's funny is, see, of course, all of these are rational, right? It's like Fibonacci. So all of these are rational. Each of these Zn is a rational. It's a polynomial in a coordinate. But of course, to write down the explicit solution, just like Fibonacci, I need more. I need the golden ratio. So maybe there's a way of thinking about that as some kind of sequential approximation. I don't know. I would like to think about that some more. Yes, but that sounds like an interesting comment indeed.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask a couple of questions?
Of course, well.
Okay, the first thing is, if I understand correctly, this is for a scalar finite cube theory with massless particles, am I right?
Oh no, sorry. So I should have made this distinction before. So I was talking always about n equals 4 Supiang-Mills theory in the planar limit. Now there is another appearance of these tropical Grassmannians in the theory of scattering amplitudes. And in actually that other application of the same mathematics kicked off our interest and provoked us to apply it to this example of Yang-Mills theory. And in that example is exactly as you said, it's related to actually a kind of generalized phi cubed amplitudes, where now you don't have kind of standard kinematics and momenta, but you have generalized Mandelstam variables, which have kind of higher ranks of indices. And I think maybe you're thinking of the work of Cachasso and collaborators when you were talking about these phi cubes. So that's where that came from. It's okay. The kinematics here, these are ordinary amplitudes. There's momenta behind, ordinary momenta, ordinary Mandelstams. And the Grassmannian arises as literally the kinematic space in the way I described, but it's only GR4n, whereas the other application is more interested in GRkn for general k, but there's no analog of momenta. There's just generalized Mandelstam variables obeying kind of generalized momentum conservation relations.
Can I continue with some more? The first remark, in relation to Werner, Paddy approximation, the statement that the minors are all positive are typically necessary in sufficient conditions for solving a moment problem. Steel, hamburger, there are a lot of moment problems, and they, under appropriate conditions, uniquely determine a distribution function. Has anybody studied it from that point of view?
I do not know, I'm afraid. Yeah. Sorry, was this question for me or for Werner?
For whoever.
So yes, I'm afraid I don't know the answer to that. I still need to think about this this idea of Paddy approximants. It's not something that suggested itself immediately to us when we were thinking about this way.
Okay. Then regarding singularities, there are all these results from Epstein Glaser and from Bogolyubov, okay, and recently also from Friedenhagen and Reschner, which are essential for causality. And one can develop a perturbation theory using those things. Epstein Glaser is a causal perturbation theory. How do these things fit there? I mean, I have not seen any particular actual amplitude you have written down.
Yes, I'm. It's true that I was. I got slightly abstract quite quickly. So let me just. Whoops! What have I done? Sorry about that.
That's okay.
I think I crashed my. I think I crashed my talk. Let me see if I can get it back.
You can share it. Yeah.
So at the beginning, I gave an example of some perturbative amplitude. You probably don't see my screen now, so let me just put the screen here. Yeah. here we go. Share. Okay, good. So I hope you can see this now. So yeah, let me go to here. So the scattering amplitude that I'm talking about here is a 6-particle amplitude. And let's say it's maximally helicity violating. So at tree level, actually, it was this Park-Taylor formula that I showed right at the beginning. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I have this Park-Taylor formula, and then I should multiply this by, actually, there's some infrared divergences, which are universal and we should not worry about, but there's a universal infrared divergent factor because we have massless particles. And then once I've factored out that divergent factor, I'm going to get loop corrections that look like 1 plus, and then at one loop order, it's exactly this function that I showed here, this E1. So it's just a collection of die logarithms. So the amplitude's quite simple. This is a one loop amplitude. You should expect to see when you do perturbative calculations, you typically find logs. And here you find die logs at one loop. And it's a function of the three variables that are left over in this 6-particle scattering. So this is the one loop contribution. I factored out that tree level Park Taylor and an infrared divergent bit. So this is an explicit expression for a scatter.
Where is the renormalization prescription?
So there is no renormalization to worry about here because we're in n=4. So there's coupling is just a modulus. We have no wave function renormalization to worry about. We do have infrareds to worry about, and I just said take them out as a universal factor. So there's a way that you can find a universe. They are independent of helicity, and because I'm in the planar limit, they can only depend on adjacent momenta, right? Because they come by exchanging soft gluons between adjacent particles and then taking that momenta out soft to infinity or collinear with one of the external states. So that means in the planar limit, they can only depend on adjacent pairs. So they have much weaker, much more simple kinematic dependence than the rest of the amplitude. Mm-hmm. So you can just factor that out and then you get something interesting left behind. And it's very simple in this theory. It just has some dialogues at one loop.
Okay.
So I hope that's explicit enough as a result for an amplitude.
Okay, one final question. The question is, why do Dynkin diagrams and affine groups come appear in this problem?
So these cluster algebras, so there's a classification of cluster algebras as to when they are finite and when they are infinite. And you can, this example, this GR2, the simplest example I gave to you actually was an A2 example. Its quiver diagram was down here with two nodes. That is an A2. So that corresponds to SU3, say, as a Dynkin diagram. And if you can find a Dynkin diagram of a finite Lie algebra as one of your clusters, there's a theorem. I guess that's Fermin and Zelivinsky in studying these cluster algebras, that this cluster algebra will be finite. And so we are lucky, in a sense. It's not the general case, but we are lucky. In the first two cases of our sequence, GR4-6, GR4-6 is actually dual to GR2-6, because I've got a sort of kn minus k duality. GR2-6 is the an sequence. So that's just A3, which is here. You see in the active nodes just form a line of three nodes. So that's like SU4, the Dynkin diagram for SU4. So that's a finite Lie algebra Dynkin diagram. And indeed, I get this finite topology of mutations that shows up as this polytope. And the next example is this one, GR47. And the initial cluster is this funny looking thing, but after mutation, you get E6. And that shows you that it's finite again. And then you can go, you have the usual classification of finite dimensional Lie algebra Dynkin diagrams. And that's related to the closure of these cluster algebras.
Sorry, I want just to say thanks again, and I have to leave because Marianne has to join another Zoom seminar.
No problem. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Nice to see you.
I have a quick question about maybe the relation of this, your work and the work around us to integrable systems.
Yes.
I believe, there are some integrable techniques that work in planar cases and how this fits in.
Yes. Okay. So that's a great question. So there are two things to say. So first of all, the integrable system. All right, love. Hold on a second. Give me a second. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Sorry about that. The interruption from my.
No problem.
The important thing to say about those techniques. So there's a beautiful thing called the Wilson loop OPE, where you can slice up the Wilson loop that's dual to the scattering amplitudes into various transitions and build up the Wilson loop due to Basso-Sever and Vieira. And there, what you're thinking about not the amplitude, but rather the dual Wilson loop as a flux tube which propagates through space-time. Okay, and sort of some wiggly contour given by your light-like edges. But it starts in some vacuum state, it transitions to something, it does many transitions, and then it ends up in the vacuum state again, and then you've got a kind of transition amplitude to compute. And this flux tube can be thought of as an integrable system. You can solve for the excitations of this flux tube. Basso did this, and you can actually solve for the energies of these things, and then Basso, Sever, and Vieira were computing these transition amplitudes that you also need to build up the whole Wilson loop. However, that's a two-dimensional integrable system. So the integrability there is related to this kind of world sheet version of the theory, where you try and build the Wilson loop up from a world sheet that transitions through space-time. And the results that you get when you do that, what that gives you, it's just like the operator product expansion in conformal field theory. It gives you a big, complicated list of sums over sort of expansions around a particular kinematic limit, which is a kind of multiple collinear limit in this Wilson loop OPE. So you get, instead of perturbative integrals, you get big sums. And you have to figure out all the coefficients in all these sums. And it's highly non-trivial that the results actually match up. And it's also because you get sums, they have some region of convergence. And in order to understand the analytic structure of that as a function, you'd have to then analytically continue beyond the region of convergence and understand where all the singularities are and so on, the branch cut structure. So it's not at all immediate that you can understand the singularities from that picture. It's certainly correct, and it gives lots of beautiful information. And in particular, sort of morally, you can solve for these energies and transitions at finite coupling. So you're not working perturbatively in the coupling, but you are kind of working perturbatively kinematically. It's an expansion around a limit, which you may be able to do to all orders, but that's not the same thing as being then able to analytically continue and see all the singularities. So it's kind of, they're studying the same thing, but from orthogonal perspectives. And in fact, in this bootstrap program that I mentioned, these kind of two things were developed simultaneously, and data from one fed into the construction of the other and so on. So this was a kind of very useful thing that these two things should be giving the same thing. So that's one application of integrability to this, and how it kind of, it does give some of the information, but not all the information, and doesn't quite give you this geometry, at least not directly. There's a second sort of relation to integrability, which is tantalizing, but I don't know how it goes, which is that these cluster algebras actually showed up in the study of integrable systems in the first place. Fomin and Zelovinsky and Goncharov and the people who've been mentioned already were studying these. And I don't know if any of these quantities that we're talking about here can be related to some one of these kinds of cluster integrable systems that they were talking about. if there is, it's going to be something different from this world sheet type integrability, I think. Because here we're really talking about, it's really a more space-time approach with the kinematics of space-time. So it's more related to, if it's anything, it's going to be more related to the kind of picture of the Yangian. I didn't mention that at all, but there's a...
Yes, I was going to come to that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So there's the dual conformal symmetry that I described at the beginning. There's also the ordinary conformal symmetry of n equals 4 super Yang-Mills, which is, the dual conformal symmetry is mildly broken by infrared, and it's so mild that I didn't even bother describing it. Yeah. I just presented you the invariant results. The other in the conformal symmetry is much more dangerously broken by infrareds. However, if you take the two together, those two algebras should close onto the Yangian of the superconformal algebra. And that is a kind of a much more space-time version of integrability, because it's built up on the actual space-time kinematic space, right? This whole set of, let's say, the momentum twister variables, it's most naturally expressed in terms of those. And so I said that the dual conformal transformations are linear, but the extra transformations will become second order and even higher order that you sort of generate in this tower of Yangian generators. And that the connection of that to this world sheet approach to integrability is completely mystifying. I mean, it's not at all obvious that the two things kind of arise in the same way. Maybe it's related to this second version, but I don't know that either. But if there is a kind of integrable system that gets onto the kind of things that I was talking about here, it will be closer to related to the Yangian and maybe these cluster integrable systems.
Just speaking on the Yangian, the Yangian has this this half algebra structure associated with it as well. And your tensor products there looked like they might be heading in that direction.
Hopf algebras are a very, very general thing, it should be said, but there absolutely is a Hopf algebra structure associated to the tensor products. It's not, as far as I'm aware, immediately related to the Yangian Hopf algebra structure. Let me see if I can, here we go. Right, so on the symbol, there's a co-product that's very simple. So here's the symbol here. It's like this sum over k tuples that I said of these rational functions. Well, the Hopf algebra co-product, let's call it co-product on this, all you do is simply deconcatenate. So if I have a symbol of rational functions, k tuples, and I apply the co-product, I simply slice it into, let's say, n and k minus n for the two factors of the co-product. And the product that's compatible with that co-product is the shuffle algebra. So if I multiply two symbols, if I take I take two functions with one symbol and a function with another symbol, and I multiply the two functions, the symbol of the result is what you get by shuffling the two symbols together in a shuffle product. So in other words, you stick them together in all possible ways. You add up all possible ways such that you preserve the suborderings, like shuffling a deck of cards. Yeah, so that's the product structure. And the co-product is the deconcatenation. And that gives you a Hopf algebra on this tensor product of iterated integrals. That's a very deep thing. That's related to some stuff that I don't understand, that mathematicians love to call them the theory of motives. And so on, and they call this Galois, the Galois coaction, and it has an action on zeta values. In fact, it's anything that's an iterated integral, you shouldn't think of as a number, you should think of it as an operator. And then there's an algebra on this space of operators, and then there's a coaction on this set of operators, which include these iterated integrals here, and these iterated integrals here also include things that are numbers, like zeta 2 is ln of 1, li 2 of 1. Zeta 3 is li 3 of 1, and so on. And there's also a coaction on those zeta values, not just so you can actually act on numbers with this thing. It's a really interesting thing, and there's many things to be understood about that. one thing to say is the adjacency property that I mentioned before is immediately compatible with this co-product, right? Because it's just what, how do things sit next to each other? So if I chop something in two, both of the pieces still obey the adjacency criterion. So this was something that was, when I spoke to Francis Brown, who's one of the people who studied these kind of mathematics, this was something he was immediately enthused by, was the fact that it's compatible with the coaction. So it's an interesting problem to try and understand the construction of these cluster adjacent polylogarithms in general. Without the adjacency criterion, they're quite simple to study, or at least the ones related to AN series, let's be modest. So the simplest kind, we can construct bases. That's just like moduli spaces of Riemann spheres. So these are all things that sit on the Riemann sphere with N marked points. They're functions on that moduli space. So they're simple, fairly, well, Francis Brown studied them, let's say. But with the adjacency criterion, it becomes interesting and more complicated to construct the bases of these spaces. It's an interesting pure mathematical problem.
Yeah, lots of very interesting problems there.
And you mentioned, sorry, the Yangian. So that, I mean, there's a Hopf algebra structure, as you said, which you use to build up representations, but I don't know if it's directly related to this. I mean, there may be a relation actually, because when you apply the Hopf algebra to a Yangian generator, obviously it splits into two and you get a higher order generator, right? If you use that to build a representation, you get something that's higher order as a differential operator. Now imagine applying this to the symbol. Well, it comes along, the first guy hits the last entry, and then the next guy can, well, it can hit that again, but it can also hit the one after. So you see that the two tensor products are somehow slightly connected. More than that, I can't say, but there may be a relation between this tensor product here and that tensor product in the Yangian as a Hopf algebra.
Can I ask one more question, one related question regarding this Hopf algebras? Are these algebras quasi-triangular? And what about there is a canonically a Dirichlet double, okay? So you take also functions of, are these quasi-triangular? So are they co-commutative or whatever?
Okay, so let's see. The Drinfeld double, Drinfeld double is interesting because it gives you something that's both non-commutative and non-co-commutative.
Yes.
So this product is commutative.
That is like a group.
Like a group. Yeah, like a group. Group is co-commutative, right? So here the shuffle product is commutative because I'm just multiplying functions, so it has to be commutative. The co-product is not commutative, but it's something a bit more interesting. I don't know if you can think of it as a Drinfeld double. The Yangian, I think you can relate to a Drinfeld double, possibly via relations to affine, quantum affine algebras. Those you can construct as a Drinfeld double, I think. But I don't know if you can, the Yangian is an example of something that's interestingly not commutative and not co-commutative at the same time. Okay. And I do believe that people did examine whether or not you can relate these things to Drinfeld doubles. And in the case of the Yangian, and I'm not certain, but you can get the Yangian out of a limit of a quantum affine algebra as Q goes to one and so on. So I think, and then those things I think you can get from Drinfeld doubles. So I'm not absolutely certain, but I think you can relate it to that construction, yeah.
So I have a question about the infrared end of this analysis. Isn't that a sort of a fundamental feature of what you want to do in these problems, or
it's
I don't know how you treated them. I mean,
that's that. I didn't tell you. That's why. So but yes, it's a fundamental feature of massless scattering. And you might complain that it ruins this whole idea of thinking about scattering amplitudes and S matrices and so on, right? Because you're not meant to have infrared divergences.
It's
not
well, fine. It's hard even to define scattering, right? When you have
yes. So there are many things I can say in a response to that question. So okay, so let's think. So where does this line of analysis come from in the first place? So people study perturbative QCD amplitudes. Okay, and those are massless scattering amplitudes. Why do they study perturbative QCD amplitudes? Well, because at high energies, high enough energies, there should be processes in colliders, proton-proton collisions, where the bulk, the main bit of scattering, the interesting bit of scattering takes place in the core of the collision between two partons at high energy. And so the core of the process is some high energy hard parton scattering. And because it's high energy, you should be able to compute it in perturbative QCD. But then you get this radiated bunch of partons outside from this, what's left over from this collision. And then they start to shower and produce more partons. And then eventually those showers have to hadronize and you get jets of stuff in your detector. Okay. Mm-hmm. And in perturbative QCD also, you still have infrared divergences. So you still have to worry about those IR divergences. And then those will have to go away when you convolve with whatever your external parton distributions and your whatever you're using to model your hadronization, your shower and hadronization process that happens at the end here. Okay, so obviously it's a bit like in QED, where you worry about soft photons coming off. Mm-hmm. Here we do have to worry about these things, but there should be some factorization of this infrared structure. And then it ultimately should go away when it's fed into whatever is modeling this production of hadrons. And that is also QCD, but we can't do it in QCD. So what people actually do is create models for the shower and models for the hadronization. Okay, and sort of they have to actually model the model, right, to get an answer out for jets production, for example.
So do I understand as a separate part, as a separate analysis you have to do it?
Yeah, exactly. So you still have exactly the same. When you compute the hard scattering amplitude in perturbation theory, it's IR divergent because you have massless scattering.
Yeah.
And you have to treat those IR divergences by factoring them out in some way and remember they're there. Now
is this factorization sort of standard or not?
So in a planar theory, in the planar limit, the factorization is extremely simple, because if you think about the Feynman diagrams that enter, I'm only allowed to write down planar Feynman diagrams.
Yes.
So I've got hard lines coming out, some spokes of some wheel, and then I get a divergence when I exchange a soft gluon between two adjacent legs, but they have to be adjacent legs. I can't cross over to some random other part of the diagram because then I'd be non-planar. So in the planar limit, I can only exchange things between adjacent legs. And then I get an IR divergence when the momentum of that gluon goes soft. It's like sort of taking it off out to infinity. Or when it becomes collinear with one of the external massless legs, then I get also a divergence there. But the kinematic dependence of that divergence, because it can only see these two momenta, it can only depend on those two momenta. It doesn't know about the other momenta in the diagram.
Okay, yeah.
So that means that your IR structure is extremely simple. It's just a sum. It's a product. It's a product over wedges, divergent things that like form factor diagrams, right? Where I have external states and then some operator at the corner. And the kinematic dependence is only on these two external hard gluon lines. So there's only one thing it can depend on, which is PI dot PI plus one. That's the only invariant that it can depend on. And so there's some relatively simple exponentiation and factorization that I can take out. And you might wonder, can I do this or that? But whatever you do, it can only depend on these kinematics. And so the hard scattering process is almost insensitive to how you deal with that, because that really depends on all of the momenta at the same time. So you can't mess about with all of that dependence just from tinkering with the infrared. So you can regularize them in whatever way you like, but there's some well-known understood exponentiation that involves actually the cusp anomalous dimension that shows up and controls the infrareds of these singularities.
I think in the abelian case, the exponentiation is well studied by many people, including Fadeev and Kulish, Froglich and so forth, and leads to the conclusion that there is a violation of Lorentz invariance in QED because of the infrared terms. This is the Froelich, Strocki, and one more person. Okay? In the non-abelian case, there is no proof or even a reasonable conjecture about universality of these infrared divergences. One doesn't know. Okay? So far as I know. Okay?
They shouldn't be universal though, right?
Sorry?
You don't expect them to be universal, do you?
Nobody knows. Okay, there are conjectures in the non-abelian case. In the abelian case, there are proofs. And Froelich, Morchio, and Strocki, okay, discuss it in some detail, and also older papers by Rockstorff, who discuss it in detail. Okay? And there Fadeev and Kulish have an explicit proof of how to take out the infrared divergence, showing that it is because of the wrong choice of the asymptotic Hamiltonian, okay? And they correct it with an extra factor and cure this problem. But that is in the abelian case. In the abelian case also, there is a striking result that Lorentz invariance is violated. And that is a very precise result. Okay? In the non-abelian case, there is no result that I know. Okay? So what does it know, whether it is universal, what is it? You can do it graph by graph, but one doesn't know what happens.
It's probably more controlled in this n=4 case. There's also a massive deformation you can do for n=4, which will preserve isn't there?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, if you want, at least in the planar limit, you can go onto the moduli space of the scalars and give the scalars some vevs.
Exactly.
And then in that case, there's no infrared anymore because it's all regularized by the masses of the external scattering states. And in fact, you can even tune it so that the external states remain massless. But in every Feynman diagram, you'll have an external massive loop. And at leading order in large N, the only massive lines are the outsidemost loop. And then everything else on the inside is massless. The external lines are massless. Mm-hmm. And then you get a completely finite scattering amplitude. And it's regularized by that mass so that if you take the mass small, you'll get logs of that mass appearing.
Which seems to fit much closer to your description of QCD and setting, to me at least.
Right, exactly. Yes, that's a good point. So I would think. I mean, I'm almost certain that you could think about justifying the exponentiation. In fact, I think you can very much justify the exponentiation because it actually then becomes related to Reggie behavior. Yeah. So if you can relate the kind of soft singularities, the soft behavior of the scattering amplitude to Reggie limits, which a priori are different things, but because in this theory we have dual conformal symmetry, actually they end up being related to each other. And so if you buy Reggie behavior, exponentiation in the Reggie limit, you will derive the exponentiation of the soft factors in the infrared. So that would be, if you're happy with Reggie behavior, that would be a derivation for the behavior of the infrareds in this theory.
I should probably stop the recording. It's getting into 2 hours at this point, so I'm going to thank you and stop the recording, but it doesn't.
Okay, no worries.
Beautiful talk. Thank you very much.